coming. I'm Chad Boles. If we haven't met, you know, thanks and welcome in our home. This is my wife, Cyn, the brains of the operation. Anyway, thanks for coming and supporting Catherine. I think a lot of us have the same kind of free market principles and small government ideals that she has. I think she's the best candidate in the House District 80 race, and that's why we opened up our home. I'll let Catherine take some answers and questions on your way out. If you'll grab one of those signs out of the front yard, and two if you like, and you can put them in your front yard, and we can spread the message that way. And with that, Catherine Bernard, your next House District 80 representative.
Well, thank you very much, Chad.
Thank you.
Introduction, Chad, and to Chad and Cyn for opening up their home for this fabulous meet and greet. Also, Pat and Stephanie Thomas, who hosted our meet and greet last week. Tochi Blad is going to be hosting another one. The Martins, the Mayors, Brock Fisher. We're going to have a lot of fabulous events because there's a lot of people who are excited about the opportunity to really make a stand here in House District 80 for accountable, sensible government that makes sense across party lines. So, I'm Catherine Bernard. I'm running for House District 80 State Representative. I live just about a mile over that way on Oaklawn Avenue in between Apple Valley and Caldwell, and I love living in Brookhaven. It is fantastic. My husband and I, actually fiancé at the time, bought a house here in 2011 while I was still working down in Dublin as a public defender, and I moved up here full-time in 2013, and it's fabulous. You can walk to the restaurants, you can walk to shops, we've got town Brookhaven, we've got, you know, the beautiful woods, we've got suburbs, we've got urban. You know, it's really just one of the greatest places in Georgia, and I feel so tremendously lucky to live here. However, there are some hiccups that we've had along the road, to borrow the terminology that was used at the city council meeting last night. And I think it's really important that we make sure not to export those hiccups up to the state house in the special election that we have coming up on July 14th. I think I'm the best candidate to represent all of us. That's Brookhaven, Sandy Springs, and Chamblee in the state house for three reasons. I always try to boil it down to three reasons for a speech. And it comes down to experience, ethics, and effectiveness. Experience. You know, I'm a lawyer. There's three lawyers in this race, so you're gonna be stuck with one of us no matter what. So how about pick the one who actually has some legislative and courtroom experience, who has the experience to be in the environment that a state representative is going to be in. This past spring, and I see some folks who have worked with me on it, I was up at the legislature speaking in front of committees, testifying, working on bills to protect our constitutional rights that I had some subject matter and expertise on because of my work as a public defender. It was a fantastic experience. We were able to successfully get two groups of bills that would have infringed on Georgians' constitutional rights. We were able to get them defeated, and it was a great introduction to the process. And it was a great follow-up on what we did here in Brookhaven last fall. I look around and I see many people who helped us on the Redevelopment Powers Law campaign. That was a law that was put on our ballots as Brookhaven voters. It was called Brookhaven Redevelopment. Sounds pretty innocuous, right? But if you actually read the bill, what it was a massive expansion of debt and eminent domain powers. So that was troubling on a lot of levels, that something was snuck onto our ballots for us to consent to that would have actually removed constitutional restrictions on how our city council members can put us into debt. Really, the city tried to sneak it past us is the only way to put it. But fortunately, we caught it. We read the law, we looked at the consequences of it, and we told people about it, and we voted it down 60-40. And even some of those 40% said, man, if only I'd heard about this sooner, then I would have voted against it too. So it was a classic example of how citizens getting together and actually finding out what's in a law and determining it's not the best thing for our community, it actually works. So I have the experience at this, you know, ballot question level, at the state legislative level, and in the courtroom, where as a public defender, I see laws being interpreted every day. I hear even the judges complain about how they're being written, and I see the impact that they're having on Georgians all over the state. So it's my experience in those areas that makes me the best choice for state representative for House District 80. The second E on the list is ethics. And I'm an honest, principled person. Everybody will sit up here and tell you that they're an honest, principled person. But you can look back at my track record of involvement in politics and the reasons that I've gotten involved and the actions I've taken since becoming involved to know that I do live up to that standard, even when it's risky on a personal level. You know, the Redevelopment Powers Law seemed like it was going to be really popular at first. There were a lot of people behind it who had some money that they wouldn't come out and really put their names on it, but there was definitely a sense of, oh, the city's pushing it, so they're gonna get what they want. But I was willing to stand up and say, no, you know, we need to understand this. We need to take a second look. So that tells you what my priorities are from an ethical perspective. Not trying to do something for personal benefit or to help people who are donating money to me or anything like that, but looking at what is actually best for our community and making a decision based on that. You know, I'm a public defender. A lot of people have asked me, is that a hard job? Is it difficult to defend guilty people? And I always say no. It's the easiest thing in the world. If you actually have somebody who's guilty, you can just say, here's your plea, you shouldn't have done that, and move them on their way. What is so troubling and challenging is the number of people that I find myself defending who don't deserve the way they're being treated. And that is where the ethics really comes in. That's where you're really tested when you're in an environment where it's easier to go along and get along, but you're going to be sacrificing the interests of somebody that you promised to protect. So you are in that position as a lawyer of choosing, do I want to get along with the judge and the governor and all these people who already have power? Or do I want to represent the constitutional rights of the individual who that's my job to do? And I've picked that over and over again, and I'm proud to do it. In my last election, some of you might have wondered where I went for 2 weeks before the primary. It was because I wasn't able to get out of a murder trial for a man who was innocent of the charge. So that's what I spent the last 2 weeks doing. I'm not saying I would have won the primary, but for that. But it's important to choose the most important ethical responsibility, and that's what I will always do. And you have a track record that you can look at and see that that's going to be my choice. As I've been involved in Republican Party politics for the past 3 years, from being a national delegate in 2012 to running for first vice chair to serving on district executive committees, again, there have been countless opportunities to go along to get along. I've been offered positions. I've been offered opportunities as long as I would just say something different, and I've never taken them. So there's a lot of people who will say, sure, I'm going to be able to turn down what they're offering up at the state legislature because they've never been in that position before. They don't know how hard it is. They don't know the social pressures that you're facing when you're the one holding things up and everyone else is saying, can't we just get out of here? But no, I take the law a lot more seriously than that. And the people in this room take the law more seriously than that. So we deserve a representative who will always behave with the highest ethical standards and never try to cut corners to benefit a family member or to benefit a personal financial interest at the expense of the community. The last part of the ease is effectiveness. And now some of us who've worked in the legislature before can be a little nervous about that word because it's often used as code for going along to get along. Well, I just got to make sure that I'm effective. But based on my experience and what I've encountered, is people are actually ready for something different, as crazy as it sounds. There's a lot of people up at the Capitol, there's a lot of people in the justice system, there's a lot of people in our community who feel the same way that we do. They're ready for accountable government who actually answers to the people, who actually does what they say they're going to do. They're just saying, well, I'm a little nervous about standing up for it right now. There's not enough of us. I'm here to tell you that there are. I've been going around the state for the past 3 years, working in Dublin, working here in Atlanta, working in Union County, working in Valdosta. I've been all over the state, and everywhere people have told me, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you so much for standing up for these positions. I feel the same way. I've just been waiting for someone else to say it. So we're at the point where there's enough of us that we can make a difference. That's what we did in the legislature this spring. And because I already have those connections, because I've already had those conversations with people around the state, I'm ready from day one as your state representative to continue those conversations. I won't have to start from scratch. I won't have to start building them. I won't have to worry about, well, I'm trying to think of a more elegant term, but sucking up to people at the state capitol. I'm not gonna have to do that. I'll be able to hit the ground running and talk to these people about the issues we already agree on. Smaller government, accountable government, government that really does what it has promised to do. These tremendously simple things that just aren't getting done because of a culture of corruption and tolerance of that corruption at the Capitol. So those are the reasons that I think I'm going to be our best option for state representative, and why I've been so honored to have so many people support me so far. Thank you so much for coming out today on this. I think that really pretty much covers the reasons I'm asking for your vote, and for those of you who have joined us from outside House District 80, why I'm asking you to think of those people that you know in Brookhaven or Sandy Springs or Chamblee that you can call and say, hey guys, we've got a challenge. We've got somebody who's ready to go to work for us, but we're up against a good old boy system that might be trying to put someone into office who's compromised because they're going to be more pliable. They're going to do what the interests outside of Brookhaven want. They're going to do what the interests outside of the district want. And we want somebody who is going to be accountable and responsible. I've got the track record of it with the Redevelopment Powers Law, with my work in the legislature, and my work within the justice system, both in my nonprofit and as a public defender, has given me the experience with the law to know how to take it seriously. You know, I went to Emory for undergrad, I went to UVA for law school. I was that kid who went to debate camp every single summer at Wake Forest and University of Kentucky and Longwood College. And I spent my life studying this. I really enjoy looking at the way government works and how we can make it work better for all of us. And I think there are enough of us who are ready to take it seriously that we can do something about it. So what I'm asking you to do is vote for me for House District 80 for state representative, and to call your friends and ask them to do the same thing. As much as I hate to do it, I'm going to have to ask you to give me some money too, because these mailers we're sending out are going to cost a lot. But I've got a team who is committed to making sure that we are going to be successful, and that we're going to be successful in representing everyone here in this room and everyone throughout House District 80. So thank you so, so much for your time. Thank you to my husband, who is patiently going through another campaign. Fortunately, we have a campaign office this time. It's not out of my house. So stop by and visit us above Nuts and Berries. And at this point, you know, I'm happy to take any questions. But again, thank you so much for your time, and I'm excited about this opportunity. Have a Republican majority, and it's a pretty substantial majority, and yet we're still seeing expansion of government and money being wasted on things that, you know, regardless of your beliefs on big government, you know, money shouldn't be wasted in the way that's happening. And these people, these Republicans, are all complaining about President Obama trying to usurp the legislative role, trying to issue executive orders that overstep his boundaries. But then those same people will turn around and say, well, I voted for this bill because it was the governor's bill. And I'm thinking, where's the connection here for y'all? And so those of us who have studied constitutional law and who value the limit part of limited government are really seeing a contradiction, and there's more and more people who are willing to stand up to it. I'll note David Stover, the representative from Noonan, actually gave a speech from the well this legislative session where he said, I am here to speak against the divine right of kings, and called Nathan Deal an authoritarian. It was a brave speech, made all the better by the fact that one of the governor's floor leaders came up right after him, Christian Coomer, and proceeded to prove everything he said correct by saying, you shouldn't listen to that guy. you guys have got to watch the video. I can't even do Christian Coomer justice. But you've got to watch the video, because he literally got up there and said, well, the governor wants you to vote for this, so that's what you got to do. And unfortunately, that has become socially acceptable for them to say. So what we can do is make it not socially acceptable. When a representative tells us something like, well, I did it because the governor told me to, or I did it because the judges gave me no choice, we say, remember your role. You are the legislature. You are the ones who write the laws. You are the ones responsible for this tremendous authority. Don't give it away to other people. Don't refuse to take responsibility for what we elected you to do. And so that's what I want to do, is not only be a voice for House District 80, but help inspire and stiffen the spines of the other legislators who know there's something wrong, but just have a lot of connections of their own that they are struggling to speak up on. Sometimes it just takes one voice in a room to change the culture, and I think that's what we can do. So yes, long answer to your question, but the answer is yes. Yes.
Catherine, how do you think you can sustain that? Because it sounds like, given what goes on in the state capitol, you're swimming upstream. It takes a lot of energy, and it's day after day, it's week after week, month after month, and many people that go into government go in with great ideals. You've got wonderful ideals. That's why I'm here, and I'm not even Republican. I'm not Republican, so for anybody, there you go. Okay, you know, and I don't know personally, but I know from my experience in working in the corporate world, it takes an awful lot to go against the grain and what's happening there. Why do you think you're going to be the one that's going to stay that course and not bend over after a while and just say, you know what, I can't do this, it's too hard, and I'm not getting ahead, I'm not getting the things I want supported because I'm always the one that's, you know, going against the grain here. How do you do that?
That is a great question, and you know, like I said, when I got started in politics, it was, you know, as a delegate at the 2012 National Convention, and had the experience of, you know, they asked all the delegates to stand up, and I thought, oh, they're probably going to clap for us or something. That shows you how naive I used to be about politics. What they were doing was saying, now, is there anyone here who is not supporting Governor Romney? Immediately, everyone sat down. So I got to have an exchange with the chairman of the party and the general counsel in front of the chair of the RNC, the governor, the secretary of state, the lieutenant governor, all the constitutional officers, all the representatives, pretty much everybody in the Republican establishment in Georgia, all in one room. And that was my introduction to them, was getting into an argument, which I didn't even think was an argument. I was just sharing who I was planning to vote for, and it was not the same person they were trying to force me to vote for. So coming into politics with that experience really has defined my later experience in a way that I did not expect at the time at all. Because it basically set my principles up very early on and allowed a lot of people, even the ones who didn't agree with me, to say, I respect what you're trying to do. So I've been able to build that, I don't know what the word is, for lack of a better word, brand of somebody who is willing to stand on principle. And I think I've been able to align my incentives with those of a group of people who are looking for the same thing. So I've been offered the buyouts. You know, they've offered to help me with other positions if I would just run for something different. They've made those offers, and I've turned them down every time. And the one thing that I'm most excited about is the way that we are reaching outside the political circle. And that's why Brookhaven and Sandy Springs and Chamblee are the perfect place for this. You know, when you talk about politics, nobody cares about politics. You know, politics is boring and petty, and you know, there's no point to it. We're not doing politics here. We're doing government. We're doing our community. We're deciding on the rules that should govern, you know, the way that we interact with each other. And that's something a lot more serious. And so now that we have been able to align with you know, groups of people in the Republican Party, you know, constitutional conservatives, with my criminal justice reform activism, we've aligned with people, you know, more traditionally on the left. And then Brookhaven is a very post-partisan place. You knock on doors, people say, I'm really more of an independent. I decide based on the person. I decide based on the policy rather than stereotypes that somebody else is trying to stick a label on. So it's, you know, it's a gamble. This is not something that has been done a lot of times before, but I think we're in the perfect place to actually put a proven reformer, somebody who has stood up for principles and who is going to continue to do so, to put that person in a position, a state representative, where I can keep doing the same thing. It's all about building that group of people who is willing to stand behind it, and I'm honored to say that they're just great people all over the state, and it seems like more every day. I think Sharon's here. We had a fantastic lunch today with Neil Franklin, who is the executive director of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Fabulous guy. And you know, we were talking about some of these incentives that you face in the nonprofit world and the government world. And really, sometimes it is just a matter of simply seeing the worst of it and just shaking your head and saying, no, you know, me and my friends would like to do something different. And actually, there's more of us than there are of you. That's pretty much it. And I'm counting on everyone constantly holding me accountable, because that's what we do, you know? It is foolish to think that you can ever completely overcome cognitive biases. That's why they're so scary, because you don't notice them while you're thinking about them that way. But if you make yourself open and you are able to let go of the ego associated with being wrong and just treat it as, hey, we're all gonna be wrong about something at some point. The important thing is what you do when you find out you're wrong. Do you double down and say, oh, well, it would be too embarrassing to admit that? Or do you freely say, hey, thanks for bringing that to my attention. You know, let's figure out a better solution. And too many of our legislators are stuck in this ego track of, oh, well, if I don't know all the answers, then, you know, I must not be a good legislator. A good legislator is a representative. A good legislator should not be a career politician. It should be somebody who takes their turn, you know, up there making the laws, and then goes back to being a member of the community just like everyone else. Interrupting the career politician track, which is not something I'm interested in, is a key part of interrupting that go along, get along cycle. As for being exhausted, yes, it is tiring. You know, I go to infinity yoga, it always energizes me.
Okay, so
to
follow up, how about the communication? When Brookhaven started, you and I have spoken about this and talking about it with some other people in the room, the whole reason that Brookhaven became a city, the people that voted for it, was certainly accountability, transparency, and representation. And right out of the gate, as we all know, most of the community did not feel represented because of the whole big pony fiasco. And by the way, I did, you know, acknowledge your wonderful letter to the editor about that. You took a stand, it was courageous, and really respected that. So how will you communicate with your constituents so that that doesn't happen? You know, I mean, what took place with the Pink Pony was a disaster in terms of this city getting off the ground. You know, it gave all of the anti-city people so much to attack. I supported the city, and I was so disappointed by what took place. So, you know, before you take a stand on the position, how do you go about kind of getting a feel for what the people want?
Well, there's a lot of different ways. I try to stay very accessible through a variety of, you know, media. I spend probably too much time on Facebook, but it is a great way of testing sort of the feelings of the most active citizens. You know, Nextdoor is also a place where a lot of people share their opinions. Town halls and meetings. You know, I go to pretty much every city council meeting that I can make it to. I participate in the committees. You want to be where the people with opinions are, so it's not just, you know, hearing what they say in response to your questions, but hearing what they're saying when they're offering their opinions on other things. You need to be a part of the community, not just as a legislator, as, you know, here I am seeking your opinion. You know, no, you're a part of the community who needs to go in, and it's your responsibility to see what's a priority for other people. So I would be continuing that practice of participating in as many community activities as possible to get that pulse. I'd also like to hold more town halls. You know, one thing that disappointed me last spring is, well, I mean, it was great to get so many reports from my state representative. We'd never gotten so many reports before. And in fact, this session, when he was not facing a challenge, we did not get any reports, unfortunately. So too often it seems very tied to election year. And I'm trying to collapse that distinction between campaigning and governing. You know, I heard David Ralston, the Speaker of the House at Atlanta Young Republicans recently, and he said some real troubling things about the transportation tax. He said, there's no way we could have gotten it passed during an election year. And, you know, he said that like it was a normal thing. Like it was okay to say, well, you know, if we'd had to be accountable to the people, there's no way we could have gotten away with this. And that's not an okay way to look at things. And I think Brookhaven, because we are a tight-knit community, people see each other, you see each other at the grocery store, you see each other, you know, at Kaleidoscope and Verde. You know, we have that contact with each other where we can stay in touch a little bit more easily, and I think that helps us, you know, all hold each other accountable. So town halls, staying involved in multiple activities, and I also want to explain every vote publicly. I think you should not have to go track down how your representative voted on an issue. That should be information that's being pushed out to you. I mean, this is a job interview. You know, y'all, at least those of you who are House District 80 voters, you are the bosses who are looking to hire somebody for the position of state representative. So I'm presenting my qualifications, and you know, it's not my place to argue with people about what they're choosing to do there. It's my position, it's my place to say, here's how my experience is suggesting that we should act, but I definitely need your perspective, and I'm always going to have to explain my position to you. Too often we see these politicians who feel like they don't have to answer to their constituents, and you're just thinking, what? How are you confused about this? This is the main job of a politician, but they've just gotten so, you know, caught up in their little gold dome world that they've forgotten about that. And House District 80 is the place that we can make them remember. So, another long answer. Sorry. Thank you all so much for being here. Like I said, we need money. We need money to get these mailers out. So please, anything you can give is a huge help. If you can ask your friends, you know, even, you know, $25 is a huge help to us. Like I said, we've got a campaign office above Nuts and Berries. We've got our wonderful folks there helping out, who I will definitely recognize. We've got our campaign manager, Matt Gertler, is here somewhere. And consultant Monica Matthews, treasurer Dave Rittenhouse, event coordinator Coleman Williamson, and then there's just, of course, countless other people here who have just been tremendously helpful. We're going to be walking. We're going to be doing a lot of door knocking, so anybody who can come out for any amount of time, we would love to have your help with that. We're going to be having more meet and greets, and we're going to be doing phone banking too. So even if you don't want to walk in Brookhaven, which let me tell you, I've walked in other districts, Brookhaven is a fabulous place to walk. Beautiful neighborhoods, shady streets, you know, it is a fun activity, and you really meet a lot of interesting people that way too. So I'd really encourage you to come out and walk. You'll meet some really great folks, you know, other volunteers, the people whose doors you're knocking on. And, you know, get involved. We're trying to make politics better, and that is a tough task, because it's pretty awful sometimes, but, you know, what's our other option? Just letting it get worse?
Introduce your husband.
Oh gosh, she's gonna hate this. Come on, Eric.
Come on, Eric.
I can vouch for what she said about resisting temptation. this girl with her MBA law degree could be rich, and as her husband, that means I could be rich too. And she's turned it down to pursue the good fight. I'm so proud of you.
Aww. Hey. And I will note, you know, he is the one who makes it possible. You know, it is a hard slog, and I see a lot of other activists facing, you know, it is hard to get down to the Capitol and make a living while all this is going on. But, you know, I'm in a fortunate position that my husband is making it possible for me to do this, to be a public defender and to fight this good fight. And so it's a lucky situation, and I want to try to share the blessings that I have in my life and make sure that as many Georgians and people across the country have those too. And we have awesome lives here in Brookhaven, and we want to make sure they stay awesome, and we want to make sure that we can spread that example as far as possible. So
thank you, Eric. Thank you.
That's it. You know, thanks everybody for coming. You're welcome to stick around till 8:30. We've got plenty of time left. There's plenty of beer and wine and Cokes and lemonades. And thanks so much for coming. And like I said, you know, if there's another person that has a brighter future, is more competent in the race, vote for them. There's not, so vote for Catherine or not.
Continue. And I will be around, you know. Talking about politics is something I can do. It will put up promises.